Hello, hello.
How's it going?
Are we allowed to talk yet, Angelica?
There we go. I was wondering why I couldn't see everybody.
Yes, Carl, you may speak.
Good.
We're going to let Carl speak. Hey, everybody. All right. We're excited. It looks like we have, obviously, marketers. Carl mentioned we have some sales folks here, which is
I see some fellow sales savages. I see Brendan. I see Matthew. Here we go. Who else? Raise your hand if you're a sales savage.
Excellent.
Again, we're still the smallest crew in the brunch. I always say that I'm the perpetual like confused seller because I've like sold marketing to marketers for like my entire sales career. So I don't know. Am I in sales anymore technically, or am I a marketer? I don't even know anymore.
It was a tough decision to allow Carl on this episode because he should really be out selling.
It's risky. That's
what he should be doing right now.
It's risky.
So, all right. Hey, everybody. Welcome to our latest Stacking Growth Live. I'm Casty. I'll kind of moderate this session and we'll introduce Allison and Sydney or and Carl here in a second. Better yet, I'll let them introduce themselves. Super excited about this topic. So obviously, y'all know our point of view from Refined Labs around creating demand and manufacturing revenue and the need to obviously capture that demand. Declared intent or high intent leads, people raising their hand on the website, coming inbound, so forth and so on. We all know that story. We love seeing marketers who are adopting this, both within our clients and within our community. It's fabulous. But one thing that naturally falls out of this is like what happens after somebody comes in and raises their hand through the sales process. I've lived this myself as a CMO, where we were able to create a very strong demand creation engine, only to have to go figure out how we make the sales process efficient. Carl and I talk about this every day at Refined Labs because we run the same motion within our company. And then obviously Allison and Sydney see this every day with our clients. So what we thought we'd do is just have a conversation about what this looks like, what needs to change. I would like this to be very back and forth. And so one of the things I'm working on is how do I get the audience more engaged in terms of asking questions. So I'll be doing that from time to time. So get your questions ready. So before we kick off into my questions, I want to have everybody introduce themselves. I'm going to start with Carl. Carl, introduce yourself and kind of give us one thing that you see as a challenge between kind of the marketing and sales relationship in this kind of demand creation world.
Nice. Thanks, Cassidy. Carl Ferreira here. I lead the sales org at Refined Labs. I've sold into kind of the marketing persona, if you want to say that, for most of my sales career. I came from HubSpot previously. And the one thing that I think harms the cohesiveness or relationship between marketing and sales, especially when it comes to kind of the buying process and crafting a well-designed inbound buying experience, is just trust. And I think we'll dive into that a little bit more, but there's trust that's been harmed between the two silos or organizations, I think historically, and there's some work to do and some tips and tricks, at least from the sales side here, that marketing teams can do to rebuild some of the trust that's been eroded over the years.
I love it. And we obviously can't have this conversation without a salesperson on the phone. So Carl is our representative. Allison, first time in a live session. Happy to have you here. You're usually out supporting our customers. We'd love it if you introduce yourself.
Hi, my name's Allison Lohman. I've been with Refined Labs for over a year now. Started as a director of demand generation and now am a VP. So I've got a team of amazing directors and performance marketing managers, and we're supporting anywhere from 8 to 12 clients. So the main reason I'm excited to be here is my entire career, I've always been really focused on creating alignment with sales. I always saw that as a way to earn marketing's respect and place within an organization, is to earn that trust of the sales team and the sales organization. When I think about sort of the biggest breakdowns that I see, typically when starting to really create that demand and that influx and that increase in high intent handraisers, that biggest breakdown is really the prioritization. So getting the sales team to potentially rethink the way that they're prioritizing their outreach to these handraisers, particularly if that team has been really heavy outbound, or maybe they've worked exclusively within like an RFP motion. They tend to be more enterprise focused. So it's really shifting that mindset of like treating these high intent prospects with that same level of care that you would give it, just as you would give in an outbound motion. That's usually where I see the first sort of breakdown begin. So.
I love it. Allison's crushing it, and she's a great follow on LinkedIn, so make sure you follow her. And last but not least is Sydney. I can't do a live session without Sydney, even though she tries to get out of them every time. So Sydney, welcome back. Love you to introduce yourself.
Thank you. For the record, I don't try to get out of them every time, but you know, maybe like 15% of the time. No, I love it. I'm trying to get better at live events as well. So it's good for me to talk to you all and get feedback. But anyways, I'm Sydney Waterfall. I'm a general manager here at Refine Lab. So I oversee a team of VPs and associate creative directors that oversee our large book of business. And I also started as a director of demand here at Refine Labs. The biggest disconnect, I would definitely agree with, you know, Carl and Allison here too. I think when you transition, or you want to transition to a more, you know, create demand, declared intent, that type of funnel only, and move away from lead gen, the first thing that I typically see is sales leaders, SDRs or AEs, depending on how and when leads get routed in your sales cycle, kind of freaking out about the volume. Like, you're already giving me leads and they're already crappy, and now you're going to tell me that you're going to give me less leads, but then you're going to promise me that they're going to be better and convert better. Like, it kind of feels like sometimes maybe like a bait and switch, or like, I'm going to hook you on this awesome offer and then I'm not going to follow through. So I think that kind of plays into the like trust aspect and prioritization aspect, but I feel like that's the first like hurdle to overcome with like a revenue organization. So that's what I say.
I love that. And you teed it up perfectly. So what we want to do in this discussion is kind of paint a little bit of a picture of like the current state, which I think we've all been doing here. And then we're going to walk through kind of a framework of how to think about this within your own company. And then how do you kind of drive that change on the back end to make sure that what you want to do actually happens. And so to open this up, I want to turn it to Carl, because Sydney kind of gave our view of like the world from the marketing perspective, but like what's going on in the sales team's mind when you hear this notion of create demand? Like, where are you in kind of your current state as a sales leader? And what are you thinking when you hear this from the marketing team?
Yeah, well, I mean, the marketing team has, you know, fed the sales team not great leads for many, many years. So I'm skeptical, right? I think we have to go back in time to where sales and marketing historically have kind of come from. Sales has become, in many organizations, this entirely self-sufficient machine, right? Where marketing is really just like, actually just an extension of sales. It's like, yeah, get some leads, throw some content out there, clean up my sales decks, get me one pagers, right? Almost like administrative and subservient to sales. Sales has evolved in such a way that they've even in some organizations stood up their own internal marketing teams inside sales, right? I mean, when you think of big brands, sometimes I think of like the salespeople who are really active on social. I don't even know like if I've ever seen an ad from, you know, some bigger brands. I'm like, oh, I know one of their top salespeople or one of their BDRs that does a lot of social selling, et cetera. So when sales is this completely self-sufficient machine, and historically marketing just serves us, as horrible as that sounds, yeah, it's jarring to hear, oh, now all these leads are coming in and now all of a sudden they're gonna be high quality and we need to channel switch or context switch to now sort of like create an entirely new process, motion, and mindset around receiving these supposedly high intent leads in a more frictionless manner. Yeah, we're skeptical for sure.
What, I think you're being a little nice, Carl, so I'm gonna come back to you. So, when we think about the relationship that you have today with marketers, kind of pre-creating demand, so you're getting these leads, they're going to be thrown off ebooks, webinars, whatever, low kind of low quality leads. Walk me through kind of like, in your mind, what is the process you have set up or a typical salesperson has set up to kind of support leads that are given to them from marketing? So there's kind of an aspect of sales doing their own thing, but when it comes to the relationship with marketing, kind of what's the mentality of the sales team in terms of like that handoff?
Yeah, it's deprioritized. It's not important. I mean, it really is. It's the least of what it is that I'm going to like. I have a very packed day. My sales manager is measuring me on outbound activity. On there, we're looking at forecasting. So things that are already in my pipeline, I'm focused on that. And so I've got my target account list. I have bought marketing automation software, AKA outreach, right, for myself. So I'm doing my own high volume email blasting and et cetera. So when you see leads trickle in that historically waste my time or are not the right fit or are like a junior person where I can just go pick up the phone and call the chief growth officer at Refine Labs, Cassidy Shield, why would I bother with this Carl Ferreira who came inbound is only as a director title, right? Like, so there's just a major deprioritization, I think. It's just an afterthought, if I'm being super blunt, you know? It's an afterthought, and it forces me to context switch. I have to now step out of what I'm doing with my day and go and find where these leads are, sort through the notifications in HubSpot, see what the lead score is, etc. It's just jarring to my flow, which historically hasn't produced any fruit for me, and my time is very valuable. I'm paid on deals that close, and so my time is naturally going to gravitate in that direction.
I appreciate that, Carl. So you painted a very clear picture, but I want to kind of balance that. So I'm going to go to Allison. Allison, is Carl being overly harsh? I mean, like, kind of how do you see this when you, by and large, when you enter a new client? And I know obviously our mentality is to change this relationship over time. How consistent or inconsistent is what you've seen and experienced from what Carl is saying?
So I think skepticism is the right word to use here. Thankfully, when clients sign on with Refine Labs, I actually see a lot of excitement because usually if you're working with us, you're bought into this idea of change. Everybody wants to have that change happen within their organization. So there is this initial period of like very high level of excitement, but that skepticism is always sort of the underlying elephant in the room. So I think the one thing that has been, I've learned through trial and error is to always have the sales, someone from sales representing the sales organization on these calls where you're really influencing, trying to influence change and move to a demand generation model. Because I'll give you like a very quick example. You know, if you ask a marketing team what the ICP is, they're gonna tell you what the ICP is. But a salesperson, like there's the ICP and then there's like the ICP. Like the salesperson knows, yeah, we might be going after these industries, these verticals, these segments, but like, these are the people that close every time, or these are the people that I personally am really good with. And so I think that's just an example of if you don't have that insight, you're going to not nail it as quickly as you could if you're sort of bringing that insight in. So I think there's ways to sort of get in front of what could be a more like sort of slower start to the effectiveness of your demand generation efforts if you're involving that sales leader in from the beginning to sort of speak on behalf of really where we should be going with the strategy.
And let me follow up on that. Do you find in those situations that that involvement exists, or is that something you have, you as coming in as a change agent, push for? So where is like the awareness level within a typical marketing organization that that relationship should be in place or exist?
In my experience, actually, like I've never met a salesperson who didn't want to be part of marketing conversations. I actually think it's the fault of the marketing function in general that we don't actively seek those relationships out. I think there is a lot of fear there, that maybe fear of not speaking the same language as sales, not being as product knowledgeable as sales, or even as like business minded as sales. We tend to be more of like the creative, or the looked at as more of the creative, or maybe like some of the funnel before the funnel people. So I think there's sometimes a little bit of fear of like exposure, that, oh, we're not going to, you know, be able to talk the same talk as a salesperson, so I'm just not going to get them involved. And I think that's a major miss on the marketing function in general. And I don't think sales will necessarily volunteer. Like they're not going to give away their time if they're not asked. But I found that if you build that relationship and ask, they're actually more willing and they're more invested in the program when you get them involved.
I've experienced the same thing as a marketer and then obviously running sales teams. The sales folks are typically very giving in their time up to a certain point. Obviously they want to see something change out of the time that they're spending with the marketing organization. So there might come a point in time when nothing's changing and the sales team is deemed this relationship not worth their time. But I do agree, usually up front, they're willing to spend a lot of time. The funnel before the funnel, I had to write that down. So we'll come back to that some other time. That is a great line for another conversation. All right, Sydney, one of the things that obviously gets in the way, or one of the ways to change behavior, is through how we measure marketing and sales. So maybe kind of share with us the kind of current state versus like how you would see the future state in terms of evolving the measurement here to kind of better align the two organizations.
Yeah, I think previous state, at least how I've been measured and how I've done different things before in my career, was definitely around lead volume and volume, no conversion, no quota to hit, you know, minimum conversion to hit a quota, nothing like that, just pure volume. And then even metrics before that. So that's, I think, where it starts. And obviously the sales team is not measured on leads, they're measured on revenue and how much quota that they can attain. And some even have win rates or conversion rate, you know, qualifies into their comp, right? Like there's so many different measurements of that goes into their compensation package, which is ultimately how they're going to get paid. Yeah, I know. Sorry, guys. My dog is also upset about the MQL leads here. I've trained him well. But how, and like that's where the disconnect drives. I've been in rooms with VPs of sales, my CEO before, previous companies, and they're just literally how many leads, what source, and then, oh, it's sales problem after that. And I just think that's so, drives the wrong behavior. So when we want to think about how we should be measuring, you know, I can definitely go on a full rant around that. I'm sure we'll get into that in that topic, but it's pipeline and revenue. And a lot of marketers are saying, oh no, I drive leads. I can influence revenue and I can influence all of these things with assets I'm creating or different campaigns. But I also think influence revenue has not helped marketing and sales alignment either. I think it's actually driven it even further apart.
Say that last point again. This was like an interesting.
Yeah. So the concept of influenced revenue from like an attribution standpoint. So I'm a firm believer that you should look at how revenue was sourced, where did it come from, a source point, where did it enter in the pipeline, and not influence. So a lot of marketing teams will look at oh, this campaign influenced this opportunity. And it's like, they saw, we served one display ad to a target account that was already in the pipeline. And so now we're going to take a credit for, we influenced X amount of this revenue. And I think that by doing an influence model where we're just arguing over what percentage of the revenue we already closed, so it's already in the past that we've already closed, doesn't really align sales and marketing. They just start arguing over, no, I've worked that deal for 8 months. I know all the decision makers. You sent one email and you're going to say, or one event that they happen to show up to, and you're going to say, you guys, you know, close the deal. So I think that is really also like spurred fuel on the fire from an influenced revenue point of view and reporting.
Yeah. So this has spurred a few questions. So I appreciate folks putting those in the chat. Let me ask some of these, and Angelica, maybe you can help me in the future figure out if we can get these people on to ask the question for themselves. So the first one is, so to clarify, Sydney, are you suggesting to measure marketing by revenue or opportunity sourced? And then there's like a comment around first touch or last or both, or maybe that's not relevant.
Yeah. So I can speak to how we recommend and how we actually look at revenue here too. And that's kind of what we recommend. We recommend measuring marketing on what we call hero pipeline and revenue associated with that pipeline. So we don't necessarily look at first touch or last touch. We're looking at the what we call the conversion touch. When they converted on a high, that it could be the 27th touch, no one cares. When they converted, when they came to our website and then they filled out that book a strategy call and they go over to Carl's team to book a call immediately, where did that come from? And that's how we look at conversion touch. And then we're looking at the pipeline source that's associated with that. So when we say pipeline source, we're talking about, did that come from our website? Did that come from outbound? Did that come from an event? Or maybe you have partner. You're going to have only probably 4 to 5 like core go-to-market sources. All of newsflash, most of our revenue comes from our website, which would be our what we call pipe, our go-to-market framework. So that's how we kind of at a high level measure revenue. Obviously, we can get into exactly how we do that and how marketing looks at it, how Carl looks at it. But that's one thing that, interestingly enough, here, marketing doesn't report on the hero pipeline. Carl reports to the organization on the hero pipeline generated. So I think that's an interesting dynamic as well. I love that.
Yeah, I would like to get into that too. And so the last question here, are you splitting events and digital pipeline? I think your answer would be yes. We would look at resources differently.
Yeah, if you have an event and field motion going in your business, I would categorize that as one go-to-market source versus someone coming from into your website and converting.
Perfect. Love the questions. Keep them coming. If you want to come on live and ask, we'll make sure to make that happen. So let me kind of pivot this conversation. We'll get into more measurement here shortly. And that is like, I'm going to frame kind of the situation as we talk through. So we have the status quo. Carl's out doing his own thing, not really paying attention to marketing in a traditional world. The leads he gets from marketing, he doesn't have a lot of respect for. But now marketing's kind of shifted the strategy. We're creating demand. We're getting hand raisers through the website on a digital channel. People saying, I want a demo. We've educated it properly. We got buyer enablement set up. We see the demos increasing. This is great. People are getting excited. There's some optimism brewing. And then we see that these demo requests or hand raisers don't convert to revenue. And so this is really what we want to start talking through is how do we ensure that we're capturing this demand all the way through to revenue? And so we're going to talk through that now. And we thought we'd talk through it a few ways. One is kind of how to establish a mindset across sales and marketing to go tackle this. We'll come back and talk through measurement in more detail. What are the things you should be looking for? across marketing and sales. And then we'll talk a little bit about execution. And that I want Carl to kind of walk through. Once he gets on board with this, what's he start observing in the sales process that needs to change on the sales side to enable this more efficiently? So with regard to mindset, I'm going to ask Allison to kind of walk through, how do you think about when you're in an account, you're talking to a client, establishing this kind of different perspective of how marketing and sales should work together? So i.e. kind of the mindset that you're trying to instill and incorporate within the team.
Sure. So for me, it's kind of two important things right off the bat. The mindset is that there has to be agreement between marketing and sales, and really the whole organization, but mainly those two groups, of what is a high intent conversion. So everybody has to agree that a demo form, request a demo form, is your high intent conversion. I mentioned that because with the increase recently in like freemium or free trial or PLG motions, there's actually several steps above that demo potentially. So it could vary across the organization, but you want to have that alignment on like, what is that high intent conversion? What is that signal that everybody agrees is going to be treated as high intent? That's kind of the first mindset you need to get into, make sure you have the alignment there. And the second piece is make sure that someone from sales or growth ops, rev ops has reviewed any reports that marketing plans to use to measure success. I have been in way too many report conversations, QBRs, where the conversation immediately goes to, that's not the report I would use. Like, you forgot this filter, you're not looking at it this way. So always make sure you have the mindset of like, we're aligned on what filters we're using to report on this and how we're defining success and how we're defining revenue and everything through the funnel. So I think those are the two mindsets. You have to be locked in alignment on those so that the story and the narrative that you begin to observe is widely accepted by everybody. I think the other kind of important part here is, and I know Carl will get a little bit more into this, but who's owning the handoff process? You know, I've been in a lot of companies where, and I actually used to be the person that was like passing out these leads. And is that effective for your organization? How do you fast track that? How do you add in automation, get these leads to the right people in an appropriate amount of time? So I think those are just some of the early mindsets that you want to be focused on is who has ownership of that. And is, if it's a collective ownership, that both parties have the ability to affect the change that needs to happen, not just from capturing the intent, but then moving it through the funnel. There has to be mutual respect for the changes that are going to be recommended. It can't just be sort of one team making all the requests and the other team not having a voice. So,
yeah, I love this. The fact that these, not only do these teams need to be aligned, but they need to be aligned on the specifics is kind of what I heard from you. And that is almost like each step, who's accountable and who owns that. I suppose there's also some education you're doing up front based on what do we expect to have happen once this machine starts rolling? Whereas a sales team may not be really thinking about how would this impact their sales process, right? They might be thinking, yeah, you know, you give me leads today and I have an SDR, or you have the SDR column, or I have the SDR column, and that's good enough, right? So Allison, you'll just give me these leads and I'll just do the same thing is probably what's going through their mind, which I'd assume you would say is not exactly how this process should be run.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, you've likely heard members of Refine Labs talk about this before, but if you have decided and you've agreed that this is a high intent, good fit for your ICP, you really, from a sales perspective, need to be thinking critically about who is that first touch point that the client has interaction with. What are you going to make them sit through a discovery call before you show any part of your product? Like, those are the things that the sales leaders should feel really passionately about. They should say, like, how do we give this hand raiser the best experience possible? What what reorganization do I have to do on my team? If marketing can commit to bringing me these high intent opportunities as a sales leader, what can I do to commit that they're going to get the best experience and not fall through leaky cracks in the funnel? And so I think that's another area of mindset is sales should be prepared to do a little bit of reorganization within their current workflows to really treat these leads as gold. I mean, they should be, everybody should be invested in testing this out. Like what, it should be a level of excitement. How can you give them the best experience? Because I think everybody's invested in making something like that work. Nobody wants to see marketing disappear, you know, that tap turned off. So how do you effectively move them forward?
Allison, there's a question I want to ask you that Carl and I were riffing on earlier. And that is, I don't know if we've really talked about this. And that is, do you see the makeup or the mix of a high intent lead differ from a low intent lead? And to be more specific, my experience has been, and call that a sample size of a few companies, is that not only does a person have high intent and they're ready to talk to somebody and we shouldn't send them to an SDR, but that they're also tend to be more senior than what we typically get from a marketing lead. So it's not the junior person grabbing an ebook to educate themselves. It's typically a director or a VP or somebody with buying authority who's raising their hand to say, I'm ready to talk. Do you see that? But maybe that doesn't play out that way across most of our accounts. So I'd love to have you elaborate on what you're seeing.
I do see that. I also do see more like, you have to be cautious with just looking at title, because a lot of times I see roles in the organization that have been empowered by, say, a VP of sales, VP of, we have a lot of HR clients or folks in the, you know, IT space. So sometimes they'll empower someone at maybe like a manager role or even a specialist role to sort of do some of that initial research and, you know, sort of bring options to them. So I do think you want to treat those people with the same level of respect, regardless of title. If they've submitted that form, they're likely being told to do so, or it's part of a larger program. So I do see both. Like you'll see the higher titles typically at like maybe a smaller company. And then sometimes if it's a larger company, you do see more of those like manager, coordinator, specialist titles. And so to me, what that kind of comes down to is, it's not that they can't go to an SDR, just make sure that your SDR is empowered to also show them the product. Like they should be able to do almost everything an AE can do, maybe without the ability to close or necessarily give formalized pricing in some places, but they should be just as educated and just as intellectually able to sell the benefits and the features of your product as an AE so that they could do that in the first call, if asked. Less hoops that the client has to jump through just makes the AE's job easier at the end, but they likely will still have a big lift in working through pricing, getting referrals, some of the more like bottom funnel closer, you know, further down the opportunity stages. So that's kind of like where I see that is, it's not that it can't go to an SDR, just make sure that your organization's empowering them to act with all the tools that an AE would have.
Yeah, hey, Cassie, very helpful.
Is this a good time? Cassie, is this a good time for me to share my wild idea? Is this a good time to discuss what you and I were riffing on before this call?
By all means, let's hear it.
Okay, so
this is a Carl exclusive.
This is a Carl exclusive here. And we do this at Refine Labs. So like I've seen it work. I think and believe that there's not enough creativity actually and mindfulness and thoughtfulness that goes into lead routing to begin with. It's the wrong question, I think, to ask, should this go to an SDR or an AE? That's a wrong question, right? If Cassidy comes inbound, let's say I sell for Clary, forecasting technology, plugs into Salesforce, awesome platform. If an SVP of sales comes inbound and the lead gets routed to me and I'm a really great AE, blah, blah, blah. I went to P Club last year And an SVP of sales comes inbound and I do some pre-call research and he books time on my calendar and I see that he's got 200 salespeople. I have never forecasted at a 200 for 200 salespeople. I have no experience doing that. So why would I, even as an AE, want to take that lead? Why not route Cassidy to a subject matter expert and have space or bandwidth on our sales team to route a CMO that comes inbound, like to Refine Labs? If you come inbound and you hit certain criteria, you're not going to talk to me. You're going to route straight to an expert, somebody who has been there, done that. Because we really, really care about the contents of that first conversation. So I don't know, it's a little bit wild of an idea here, but I want a CMO to come in and talk to and have a discovery call that they would have paid for, that they would have paid time for, right? I want them to walk away from that call, whether or not they you hire Refine Labs, right? Who cares? I want them to leave with a couple of new ideas that they can action on, or maybe they can help them to understand their own problems from a different lens, whatever it is. And that's very differentiating and actually helps, that mindset helps us to close a lot of deals to begin with. But what I don't feel like, we don't allow space for that in B2B really. It's like SDR or AE. And I'm like, I think there's something else altogether that we could be thinking through that makes a lot more sense and that doesn't, like that actually serves the buyer, I think, more effectively. And also helps the sales team close more deals, right? You're going to talk to an AE if you go and talk to any other agency, right? You're not going to talk to an AE if you come to Refine Labs, right? We don't really have AEs. And I don't know, there's something there that I think is, and that changes your hiring profile too. Like, I don't hire traditional sellers typically. I hire really good marketers and then I just teach them how to sell. That's much easier than me going and finding a subject matter expert, if that makes sense. So I don't know, maybe a little wild, but I just wanted to throw that in there that we should allow space for that because I think it's compelling.
Well, yeah, you have a few people here who like your idea. Keep the comments coming. If you want to ask a question of Carl, jump on. I will say Carl is very accurate forecasting for a sales team of two. So that's good. You have somewhere to start, Carl.
100% every month.
You got to start with two before you get to 200.
That's right.
All right. So we have a question. Jonathan, I'll see if Angelica can open up the chat. Love to hear from people other than the four of us.
Yeah, Jonathan, there are two Jonathans who asked a question.
Jonathan Whiting.
Oh, yes. He asked if we could ask on his behalf. So let's see. Carl stated his skepticism of quality of lead. Why would this be worth his focus or time? Do any of you use scorecards to see if some sales are having higher conversion rates on MQL hand raisers? So one could then ask, why are they having success? What's different?
I can start to tackle that if you want. I think, again, it's that trust piece that I brought up in the beginning. I mean, from a sales perspective, we can see very quickly if the quality shifts from what we've gotten historically to what we're getting now. There's a big dramatic shift in inbound, like let's say like at HubSpot, okay? So back in the day, if someone's coming inbound and I'm taking like demo requests from job titles is an easy one to kind of suss out, right? Marketing manager, et cetera. I love marketing managers to death. They don't typically buy things necessarily, right? There's a larger group. And so when you start to see an influx of demands coming inbound, that's like CMO, SVP, VP, you know, this budget, that budget, there is a marked difference in the inbound when you're doing demand well. And I think that builds trust pretty quickly. And then there's and again, this goes back to Sydney's point, reporting, right? When you're aligned with the marketing team on what you're reporting and marketing says, sales, I'm going to help you increase your sales velocity. Your average sales cycle is 45 or 60 days on your outbound stuff. I'm going to bring you stuff that's going to close in 3 weeks. All right. I'm skeptical, but I am paying attention now. And then when those deals start closing, these buyers come in and they're like ready to go. I've done my research. You're going to start to pay a lot more, you know, as a seller, you're going to start to pay more attention. That transformation can happen very quickly, and we've seen it happen very quickly in our own customer base. So I hope that helped. Jonathan, is that helpful?
I'll go back and say, my sense is this is an iterative process similar to what Allison mentioned at the beginning. You have a common definition you've agreed on between marketing and sales, and you're going to continue to evolve that definition based on what the actual performance of those leads coming in and how they convert through the pipeline. At least this has been my experience when I've done this myself, in terms of you'd start out with probably a broad definition. But as you find out what's working and what's not working, that definition becomes more specific and nuanced. All right. So
can I, Jonathan, no scorecard. We don't have like a formal scorecard. I think it's like, are we on the same dashboard looking at what success is and seeing that these certain types of deals? So it's less of a scorecard, more of like a dashboard that we agree is marketing and sales, that is our single source of truth for anything. I would say is, I guess you could call that a scorecard, but it's more of alignment on kind of that core dashboard that we're using together.
We'll say in the beginning too, when you are kind of starting this journey, and like starting maybe trying to get that trust, you might not have the time to wait till sales velocity, right? Like depending on your sales cycle, if your sales cycle is 10 months or something, right? So it's always important when you are going to say, hey, I want to make this change, and here's why. You can bring data to show this is why these leads are better. This is why it's going to be a better use of your time and better experience for you. And then Carl, you can go, it's going to be less number of leads we're going to be hassling. They're going to have a meeting book rate, or they're going to go to stage 3 op rate at a different percentage than you're typically used to getting. And that is going to be what we're going to look at first. So I've done this with a couple of clients, as like, let's just look at the meeting booked rate as like we can get that immediately. If they're not booking that meeting from these people within, they should be booking it right at form conversion, but if you don't have that set up, if our average meeting book request to meeting book rate is 7 business days for all of these leads, we want to get that to 2 business days. And that would be like a measure of that, if it's a better use of your time. This is just kind of an example of a metric that you could use. And then you could go back, and literally you need to follow, as a marketer, you need to follow those leads, every single one that comes in, and you need to make sure that it is getting followed up on. And if it's not getting booked, you're digging in immediately and asking why. You're understanding that. You don't just set it and forget it, come back to sales and talk 2 weeks later and say, hey, did we hit this number or not? Depending on your sales cycle, you might need to look at the metrics that you're going to look at, but that would be a recommendation. You need to always have something that you're going to get agreeance. If we do this, this is the outcome. Are you good with that outcome? Yes, sales, I want that outcome. That sounds good. Great. I'm going to do what it takes to get that outcome for you now. That should be more of the rhetoric there.
I love that. And I really appreciate the chatter, the back and forth. It's great. That was kind of a long discussion on mindset. I think we hammered that point home. I'm going to go back to you, Sydney, to pick up where you just left off and talk about like, what is this measurement? Like, what is this same dashboard or same view that Carl's looking at, that Cassidy looks at, that we should be looking at when it comes to measurement? While you're talking about that, you can naturally talk about, how does Alex or somebody get a hold of what are the definitions of hero pipeline and the breakdown and so forth and so on? That was a question a while back. I want to make sure we circle back to.
Definitely. So I'll go through it first, but it's actually 4 core metrics. So it's stay with the core metrics. We don't need 17,000 metrics, but it's at the core of it. It's 4 core metrics that we're going to look at, what we call a pipe conversion. Notice that there's no, we use the word conversion, not lead. A pipe conversion is a declared intent conversion. So just like Allison was talking earlier, what is that agreed upon declared intent meaning they're telling you that they're what their intent is and filling out that form on your website. How many of those are we getting per month, per quarter? Then the next step is a pipe qualified meeting. So this is of those people, they need to be, you know, firmographically fit, that they're, you know, someone that you can sell to, and they need to book time on your and schedule time on their calendar. So this would be like the first meeting, the first meeting in your sales process. I know that there's a bunch of different sales flows and sales processes of how you might structure that internally, but that first initial, because if they're not even getting to that first initial agreement of time, it's not good quality. We need to re-optimize what we're doing at the top of the funnel for bringing in those people. So that's the second phase, pipe qualified meetings. The next phase is what we call pipe hero, which is a high intent revenue opportunity. And this is going to be unique to each organization. So a high intent revenue opportunity is that it has a rolling 6th month win rate of greater than 25%. So the reason that it's structured around win rate is, again, quality of that, and the predictability of that, right? Rather than just saying, oh, it's a stage two. Well, what is your stage two convert at? Oh, it's a stage four. Oh, it's a proposal. It's this. There's so many different definitions of pipeline. So we centered around of those, how many did that rate? Typical, what we see for a sales-led organization that we work with is going to be around stage two or stage three. But again, you need to do that analysis. And then close one, pipe close one. So those are the 4 core metrics that you should be looking at. Again, this is all based on the conversion point and what we call the pipeline source, not necessarily the first touch that came in or channel or program level, none of that. We want to see what's coming in from that intent through the website. So that's a very simple, high level definition. We do have a whole another talk on YouTube about this. We're actually go into some slides we can share where there's like screenshots of the actual framework, the definitions, and then I'll drop it in the chat here too so you guys have it. But there's some examples of like how to calculate your hero win rate and what this means and things like that. I could go on and on, but that's kind of the core definition, and that's what we report on is every month and quarter, how we're pacing to our hero pipeline and our close one revenue as the core 2 things. But yeah, Carl reports on the actually all of it, but main thing is the hero pipeline and revenue, forecast revenue as well.
I love that. So Alex, I hope that answers on how you can get a hold of this. You can also just follow Sydney and ping her on LinkedIn. She talks about this a lot, both publicly and privately with our customers. Allison, there's something you want to elaborate on here?
Yeah, so this was kind of the big unlock for me when I started working at Refine Labs, because before I had always been in-house, and when you come to a place like Refine Labs, you're surrounded by marketers, which is wonderful, kind of really helps you up your game, and you get all of these great philosophies. And this was something that was so interesting to me, because I had always been saying, like, demand doesn't stop at the form fill. Like, you have the best demand generation marketers are the ones that are creating demand at every stage of the funnel. And I think breaking it down into these 4 metrics that Sydney is referring to, it's like, you have very clearly defined stages now of what efforts do I need to put towards these to make sure that somebody is moving from conversion to pipe qualified. So it really allows the marketing team to then brainstorm with sales and say, all right, we're not getting meetings booked here. What's going on? What are the tools we need to have? What are the routing rules we need to have in place? Do we need to have something like Clearbit on the back end that's filling in data that we're not capturing on the form fill so that we're routing the best possible leads to the, you know, highest potential sales, you know, sales folks, the highest subject matter experts? Like, there's a lot of internal discussion that you can start to have at each stage. All right, they aren't moving to high rows. Why? Why are they getting stuck after that first meeting? Well, what does the follow-up look like? Do we have enough case studies for this particular industry to compel somebody to continue moving forward? Do we have references lined up? Do we have, you know, customer advocates that can support this motion? So there becomes a lot more conversation you can have than just like, we'll go run more ads in LinkedIn or go spend more on Google. Like, you start to actually be partners of the sales team, and there's a, like, very clear touch points. If you can't move from, you know, conversion to meeting to opportunity, there's very easy places you can look to start fixing things. And so I think that was a big unlock for me, is like, oh man, as a marketer, I don't have to just stop at brand awareness and getting people in. I can continue that whole journey with the sales team. And that's where it becomes really fun and really effective.
I love that mental model. That is great. I think every marketer, every demand gen marketer should be thinking that way through the complete life cycle of pipe conversion all the way to revenue. Well said, Allison. All right. So I know I have a few minutes left, and I want to kind of hit a few points on some tactical execution. So let me kind of turn to Carl. So Carl, what I want to know is why we have now, as marketers, generated a lot of pipe conversion metrics, as Sydney pointed out, but our PQM, our qualified meetings, are low. Why can't you get these folks on the phone, Carl? What are you doing? Why are we not converting them to revenue? Marketing's done their job.
Yeah.
What are the typical things you see kind of go off the rails in the sales process that you've so well fixed here at Refine Labs?
It's a work in progress. I really wish marketing would just close the deals too. That's where I'd like us to evolve eventually there to that.
That's why Carl brings marketers onto the sales team. So you get a marketing closing deals.
I get to take credit for all this attainment. And all I do is just bring in Allison and Sydney and everyone else onto calls. I'm a slacker for sure. But it's just because I don't know what I'm talking about as well as Allison does when I'm talking to the CMO of a 1,000-person company, right? It's like, I just like, you should talk to Allison or Sydney or Evan, who came from the AWS, right? So it's just, I don't know what it is. I don't know if it's like a pride that prevents sellers from doing that or what it is, but at the end of the day, you have to say, hey, if I really want to close this deal, I really want Cassidy to have a really awesome experience and make a good business decision. And I might not be the perfect person to guide him on that journey. That's okay. Team selling. I noted it in the Slack here, not the Slack, the channel, the chat, that every, like, thinking everybody's in marketing and everyone's in sales. And when you kind of adopt that mindset, things get a lot simpler. So Cassidy, you asked a specific question and we have 5 minutes left. What goes off the rails and why don't I convert people to opportunities?
Yeah, maybe just pick two or three kind of classic places that you would look at first in terms of trying to optimize this, the execution.
Yeah, the first thing is maybe a mindset thing again. That's so critical to this entire conversation. But you know, you hear this a lot on LinkedIn. Speed to lead is important. I think speed to lead is like the completely wrong metric to measure. If Brendan converts and raises his hand, he wants to buy something. And again, I've built trust with marketing and this is really good demand coming inbound, right? And we've gotten to that point. This man wants to buy something. There should be no speed to lead here. You know, it should be, how quickly can I enroll Brendan in a high value conversation? It should be speed to conversation. It is not 1998 anymore, Cassidy. There's no reason for Brendan to fill out a form and wait. You know, like, y'all ever been to Lowe's and you want like a you're in lumber and you're trying to get like a board cut and you like cannot find somebody in lumber. You're like getting your steps in. You're like walking down the aisles trying to find somebody. You got to walk all the way to cabinets to see if somebody there can like call lumber. Like, that's the experience that we give to our customers. Like, they convert, they want to buy, they're excited, they want more information, they want this, they want that. And we're like, cool, you just wait, stay in the waiting room while we route a lead and find an SDR. It's insanity when you say it out loud. It's almost embarrassing, you know? So I think that's the first thing you have to clean up. How quickly can we get Brendan the information that he's looking for? Let's get him into that high value conversation with an SME. Let's maybe follow up after he books the meeting with an email that says, hey, here's some stuff to review before our call. If you sell SaaS, hey, here's a quick overview of our, I do this in my own selling here at Refine. I send a Google Doc out. After they book the meeting, I send a Google Doc out. I'm like, hey, here's a little bit about us. Here's some of the pre-call research I've done on you. What this helps us to do in the discovery call is jump into the deep end. I don't need to give you an overview of Refine Labs, right? You read the document. You don't need to give me context that I can find on the internet of your company. Let's jump into the deep end and figure out what we can do here and if a partnership makes sense. So speed to a valuable conversation. That's not just a chili piper tool on your website. It's also the mechanics of the discovery call, which is arguably an entirely other conversation. How do you run effective discovery that gives more to the buyer than the seller takes, right? I don't want to waterboard somebody with BANT. I don't want to BANT Alex to death here and waterboard him. I want Alex to deeply understand if Refine Lab is going to be a good fit or not. And I want Alex to walk away from this call with two or three things that he can execute on and produce better outcomes on his own without me. That's a win to me. And that closes deals, you know? So I'm rambling. Thoughts on that, Cassidy?
Well, I mean, I've added the BANT waterboard to the funnel before the funnel as the two things I'm taking away from this call.
Nobody wants to be waterboarded.
All right. I know there's more things we could talk about in execution. We didn't quite get to like, how do you drive this change? But I think a lot of the answers we gave around mindset, measurement, and execution exhibited how to have these conversations to get marketing and sales aligned and so forth. Any parting questions from the audience? Yep, Carl, if you want to hear more from Carl. Carl's also a sucker for outbound. So if you want to test an outbound message, just send it to Carl. He responds to everybody. If you're selling some newfangled technology, you'll probably want to take a look at it. He's always pitching me on buying more technology. So Carl's a sucker for those.
Cassidy's a hard sell. For sure.
Yeah, I don't want to talk to anybody about new technology, but Carl will. All right, so let's go around the horn. I'll start with you, Allison. Any parting thoughts, words of wisdom besides the funnel before the funnel that you want to mention?
Yeah, I think just if you're a marketer on this call, my advice is don't be apprehensive to work with sales. Like, I think that's the first sort of roadblock to get over, just mentally think of them as your partner. And if you're sales on this call, you know, give marketing a little bit of grace at times as they start to influence this change. It's not going to be perfection right off the bat, but your open and honest and constructive feedback, like, it will make the programs better. So don't shy away from doing that. And I think most marketers want the feedback If you don't, you know, you're probably in the wrong field, but I think that's just, yeah, find ways to work together and encourage each other to be better. Not just one team or the other. I think both teams can sort of rise to the top in this situation.
Well said. Well said. Sydney, any last thoughts?
Last thoughts is your goal should be that your sales team comes to you as a marketer and says, oh my God, these leads are great. Give me more of them. So if you get like, that's the end goal. Like in Slack, we get messages or our clients will get messages from their sales team. And that's like, you completed it. You completed the shift. So.
I love that. Carl, anything more besides BANT waterboarding?
Yep. Let me know if you have questions. I have these conversations all the time. I promise I won't bant you on the first call, at least. Second one is there's no rules in the second call. I might bant you then. But yeah, happy to chat with anyone offline about any of this. We construct at Refine Labs inbound buying experiences. And so happy to chat what that looks like. And I won't charge you personally, you know, a lot of money, some, but you know, not a lot. So
I love that. We're all available. So if you want to talk more about this, this was a very entertaining conversation. Appreciate all the commentary, but connect with us on LinkedIn and we're happy to help in any way we can. Thanks.